1, 2, 3. All right, we're rolling. Greg Halvorson, Nashville, Tennessee. I hope you all are doing well. It's not doing a song tonight. Not song tonight. It's wine. Wine with Greg. It's wine with Greg Halvorson. I'm just going to chat because I took a shower, which doesn't, you know, it's pretty rare. And so I decided I took a shower, feel kind of fresh and clean. So I'm going to do a fresh and clean video. So anyway, my last video was on Florida. Please subscribe to my channel. Appreciate that. And my last video was on Florida. I went down to Sarasota and Manatee County and Tampa Bay area a few weeks ago now, and really enjoyed it. Please take a look at that video. The videos before that, going way back, but just recently, last few months, I've been doing I have a song portfolio. I live in Nashville. I'm a songwriter, unpublished. No one's ever sang my songs, but I've written 260 songs. So I'll be getting my songs out in the future. I got to rev that thing back up. But I'm just chatting. I also have some longer form, like 20 minute. Chat, like during COVID, I was doing 25 minute political videos, opinionating, opining on the culture of the, and whatnot, and telling some good stories. There's a video, if you go back 5, 6 before the songs, and it's all available. You just hit the videos there and you'll get them. About me, the time I hopped a freight train from Oakland, California to Portland, Oregon, or Eugene, Oregon, then I hitchhiked to Portland. The 600 miles on a freight train, 3 days. That was quite an experience, but. So yeah, just check out my videos and subscribe to my channel, then I'll keep them coming. And if you hit the bell and you give the video a like, I guess it helps the algorithm, so I appreciate that. So maybe we'll start a new series here. I got this kind of like my 70s fuzzy wine drinking color of wine too shirt on too. So I was like, oh, I'll do a little lounge video. So anyway, God bless you. God bless America. Cheers from Nashville. That's a little Cabernet Sauvignon from this excellent winery. I can't recommend this winery high enough. Oakleaf. Walmart brand box wine. That's what I'm drinking, and I got no problem with it. That's one of my pet peeves, is wine snobs, like, oh man, I'm not drinking that. Like, oh yeah, and then you do it the blind taste test, pour them a box of Oakleaf Cabernet against their like $50, you know, something from Napa or something. And they'll pick the oak leaf, you know, you never know. Unless as far as berries go, grapes go, the Pinot Noir and they grow a lot of that in Oregon. That's really nice. It has a different taste to it. If you ever haven't seen the movie Sideways, it's now, you know, 10 years old, plus more than 10 years old. But it's a great movie about these dudes that go through the wine country down north of San Luis Obispo, that area. So it's hilarious. But he talks about Pinot Noir. There's a scene in that movie. Giamatti is in it, Paul Giamatti, and he talks about Pinot Noir, the special qualities of Pinot Noir. He's really this huge wine connoisseur guy. And he pretty much nails it. This is box wine, Walmart brand, Cabernet Sauvignon. Anyway, so another pet peeve of mine. I was going to do just a pet peeve, Monday pet peeve video or something. But I just call it Wine with Greg, I guess. But one of the... pet peeves that came to mind when I was on my walk today. I was like, God, what can you do a video of pet peeves? And on my travel down in Florida, I rented a car. And I have an older car with a key. You know, remember those things called keys, car keys? Where are my car keys? You hang them on a little a key-shaped thing on your wall with some golden hooks, and you put your car keys there so you don't lose them, right? But Nowadays, all new cars, apparently all new cars, this is news to me. Like, this is how clueless I am on cars, I guess. Because I do have an older car that with a key. And so I don't know when they started this incredibly insane, stupid thing. But now, instead of a key, you push a button. It's a keyless car. You push the button, and the pushing of the button starts the car. Problem. This is a problem. They fixed a problem that didn't need fixing. There was no problem, and they fixed it, and it made everything worse. So this keyless little, it's like a garage door opener. It's not a key where you go in and turn the car on. You just press it, and then you put it like in the console, in the seat, in your pocket, down your pants, in your sock, on the floorboards of the car. Dude, I lost this freaking thing. You can't start the car without it. So if you can start the car when you get in, because you push the button, you don't need that thing there, but it needs to be in the vicinity. Anyway, I don't even know how it works. I don't care. It's a freaking joke. You lose the thing because it's not in the ignition thing, and you lose the thing all the time. I put it in my backpack. I put it in my pocket. I literally found it in the console, under the seat, between the seat, on the floorboard. And it's because there's no key. Because the key keeps it in one place, right? And then you put it in your pocket, and then you put it back in the ignition. That's old school, and that was good school. And this notion that there are no car keys anymore is asinine and stupid, and they created a problem. I don't know, are there like battery starter lobbyists on Capitol Hill or something? It's the stupidest, one of the stupidest things, developments, modern technology I've ever seen. A complete waste of time, push button car starting. So that really freaking, I mean, that is a major pet peeve of mine. I'll keep this thing to a minimum. That's 7 minutes. I'm cool. So anyway, that was just completely one of the things I discovered in my travels. That, I mean, it's just like every single time I came home with my buddy, I would go out and Longboat Key and Siesta Key and Conklin around the Sarasota area, Tampa Bay too. And I would come back bitching about the stupid car key. He was like, my buddy like totally agree with me. And he has modern cars. He says it's the stupidest thing ever. They created a problem that didn't need fixing. So the other thing today, or a couple weeks ago, there's these hills near my home. I'm about 5 miles as the crow flies from downtown Nashville, a little bit north of the city. If you go up in the hill, in fact, you go to the Walmart, when I go to the wine, I can see the downtown from, because it's on up a little bit of a hill. This is a pretty hilly area of Tennessee here in Nashville. There's hills around circling the city and stuff. And so I've always wanted to traverse these three or four hills. If you go across, there's a neighborhood over here where I live. And then if you go this way, it goes into the countryside. So you go up and you're like up there. There are properties, but it's very wooded, very sylvan, and very wooded area. And if there are houses, they're like 25-acre parcels with huge fields, and they own the woods around them. So huge plots. And a lot of just plain woods. And if you go up there, I go up there and see deer every time, almost probably 90% of the time I go up there in the evening, and there's deer in various areas. And so I did this hike a few weeks ago and cut through the farmer's field and cut up into the woods and did this traversing of the top of the hills. But I got in there and it was really cool. But I had found this old abandoned barn with no road around it. It had been abandoned so long that the trees had grown up. You know, if you have a crude road going into like a barn in the woods or even a house, And if you don't, if you abandon it for 30, 25, 30, 40 years, the trees go around it and there's no more road to speak of. And so I go in there and there's all these abandoned vans and vehicles and with license plates with their registration in the 90s. So, and with trees all around. So like, there's no way. It looks like a helicopter dropped them in there because there's no road. But there, obviously at some point there was a road 30 years ago, but the trees have grown over and it's non-existent now. You can't tell how they got there. So I go in there and these things are from the 90s and they're just, there's no property around anywhere. There's like, they're abandoned, moss covered, animals inside, mice, all four flat tires, completely flat tires, sunk into the mud. The tires are about halfway into the mud. So I go in there and I went back today, but there was like this bicentennial license plate from 1996. So I got the bicentennial license plate off this abandoned vehicle and a couple other Tennessee, why not me or something. And these are old vintage license plates from the 90s. So these vehicles have been in there for 30 years. So that was cool. And so nearby this van, you're in the woods, deep woods, pretty deep woods now, a field, farmer's field, completely just like 20 acres of cut grass field with nothing in it, pretty close by. And so there's creeks and rivulets and washes in there. And I go there and I see a deer spine. There's deer bones in there around. And so when I see a spine or a pelvis of a deer, I start looking around for the head and the rack, you know, if it's a male or the skull, because the skull's the cool thing to find. So I started poking around. I saw a couple of old deer bone carcasses and so not if a carcass has meat, these are complete bones. They're like probably decade old. So I go into the creek bed behind another car that's abandoned and I see an antler sticking out of the creek bed. One white antler. And I said, oh man, what, that's crazy. What's that all about? So I go down there and it's got leaves piled over it from the flood, you know, the water coming down when it rains and there's just a little bit of water in this little rivulet, this creek. And I start digging this thing out and I found the biggest deer skull. I found like a dozen deer skulls, 10 or 12 deer skulls. And this is the biggest, most massive, it's almost an elk-like find. So I stashed it. I found it at the beginning of my hike and I stashed it. I went back there today to retrieve it. So here's how big it was. It is. This is my biggest deer skull. This is a big sucker. It's nice. Look at these secondary spikes, points, and I got a little capo on there. So this is my biggest deer skull to date, and that's a nice little deer. There's another one over there, but it's got lights. It's holding up lights. So I didn't retrieve it. It's about the same size, a little wider, maybe just different shape. This is the deer skull that I found in my hike in the woods the other day. dude, look at this. Are you freaking, it's like three times bigger than the biggest deer skull that I had today. Look at the horns on that. So this is the biggest before, and this is the biggest after. It won't even fit under the screen. Look at that. That's insane. So before, you can't really tell. Yeah, you can. Look at that. Look at the comparison. I mean, it is crazy. And this is a nice little specimen here. But this is almost like you would find like in Montana, It's almost like a damn elk. I mean, look at the size of that thing compared to like a regular sized deer. And then look at this thing. So, I mean, it was just, it was insane. I mean, and so I was thinking make a point, like you can go on vacation. Like this is 1 mile from my house, 5 miles from downtown Nashville, 1 mile from my house in the countryside on Brick Church Road. And this is just freaking insane. And so I thought you'd like to see that. I mean, I think I'm going to try to mount it one day if I ever get out of this apartment. If I sell some songs and I can actually move into my house here, because I do have a house here, but it's a rental house here in Nashville. But I thought, I mean, that is just freaking, that thing is just freaking off the charts. So I thought you'd like to see that. So we got a pet peeve. I did a little show and tell. And this is a nice skull too. And this is the small one. But so I got it's not too macabre, you know, it's just nature and deer skulls are cool, right? So anyway, I was going to talk about my next trip. My next trip, the reason I went to Florida is because I was going to Oregon last summer because my mom lives in Oregon, in the Portland area. Unfortunately, she wishes she could leave, believe me. But, you know, she's in her 80s and healthy, but she has family there. My brother lives there and she's not going anywhere. She's lived there for 60 years. So anyway, the reason I went to Florida is because I got held up in Midway, Chicago, the worst airport in the nation, as far as travel snags anyway. And they overbooked the flight. Southwest Airlines overbooked the flight. And so they asked for volunteers for vouchers. They gave me $1,400 in vouchers to spend the night in Midway. And I spent the night in Midway. It was freaking hell. I didn't sleep a wink. I laid on the floor and just laid there. It was a disaster. But now I'm going to Sarasota. I went to Sarasota for 7 full days travel to a travel day on the front and back, 9 days. And so now I'm going down to San Antonio. I got an uncle. My mom's brother lives in San Antonio. He's retired there in San Antonio. And he said, I emailed him. I said, you know, I'm thinking about coming to San Antonio. Do you recommend any places to stay? And then he emailed me back and said, you can stay with me. I'm like, oh, bingo. I wasn't fishing or nothing. So I'm going to stay with my uncle. He lives 5 miles from the airport and 10 miles from the Alamo and the Riverwalk. Like, so it's just a perfect, he's very central. And he's like, he's a piece of work. He's a explorer, inventor, one of the smartest guys ever. He developed on the ground floor in the 70s. He moved to Aspen and became a developer of condos and houses in Aspen. So he's not on welfare, let's put it that way. So it should be a good time. And so I'm going to San Antonio. I've been doing some research. They got the Riverwalk, the loop downtown. It looks so cool. I'm on YouTube here. This is going to be on YouTube. Riverwalk videos are fantastic there on YouTube for San Antonio. That's one thing good about YouTube is, if you want to look up travel videos, there's a lot of good travel videos. And I'm like, I wouldn't mind making travel videos too, but I don't have a clue, although I haven't tried really, how they do the cuts. They do the cuts and then they cut in the they'll start talking about the Alamo personally, and they'll do the cut to the Alamo, and then they'll do the self-talking, and they'll have cuts of themselves talking. So I don't know. I'm sure the software, there's apps and stuff, but I haven't. The production of those videos of the people with like 100,000 followers, 50,000 followers, they know what they're doing as far as editing the video. And I've never really learned how to do that. Although I think I would... Dude, if I freaking did travel videos, I would be, I think content-wise and entertainment and going around and the way I like to get after it when I go to a city would be up there. But you gotta make good videos though, right? But anyway, so I'm going to San Antonio. I'm excited about that. You got the Alamo. You got the National Historical San Antonio Missions. The old missions are spread out across the way. You got San Fernando Cathedral. And I'm going to go to Fredericksburg, which is 70 miles up the road. There's 60-plus wineries around there. There's some good hiking. There's rivers. Going to go to New Braunfels. I'm just going to just go and just cover San Antonio. I was thinking about going to Austin because that's like 100 miles away or 90 miles or whatever, but it's too much. Austin's a whole nother big city. I think it's even bigger than San Antonio or something. So I'm gonna wait on Austin, even though I've never been. I'd like to see it, but I don't want to spread yourself too thin. I'd rather go to a smaller town like Fredericksburg, go up a country road through the hill country for 70 miles and go to a bunch of wineries and check out the old German town of Fredericksburg. So that's my next adventure. So stay tuned for that. If you want to look at photos, I got good photos on Flickr. My name, Halvorson. Halvorson, my name with a G on the end at Flickr. And I'm on Facebook at Flickr, Halvorson also, where I put song lyrics, poetry, funny videos, all these videos and just little pictures, a lot of them recently from Florida up there on my Facebook page. So those are good ways to communicate. I love photography and I think you'll like my Flickr, which is a good website if you like to put up your photos. And if you put up enough photos, I've had Flickr for like 6-7 years now, and it's just like a timeline of your life, you know, because I'm pretty discerning about, what photo I want to put up. So I'm not just going to just slap and picture. I'm like, this is a cool photo, refine it, edit it a little bit, make a good title to it, put the location of it. So I put some thought into my Flickr photography. And so that's about all I got. Glad you saw my rack. Cause who doesn't like a big rack, right? So that's about all I got. This is going 22 minutes now. Attention span of Americans is pretty short. This is my big find in the woods, 1 mile from my house, from my apartment, and 5 miles from downtown Nashville. The big man in the woods, looks like an elk, might as well be in Alaska. God bless you, Wine with Greg. Maybe we'll do this again. I need to drink more and talk less. God bless you, God bless America. Keep fighting for freedom and keep poking around. We'll see you again real soon. See ya.